Unless the Lord guards the city,
the guard is lost in vain.
Do not toil anxiously from dawn through the night.
The Lord is asleep to those who are lost, the night for their needs, night for the day.
Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He is atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world.
Loves to take care of you. We just have to trust in God that he knows what we need, and then he will give it to us. So I want you just to remember, don't worry, be happy, because God loves you and he'll take care of it. Can you all remember that? All right, let's say a little prayer about your next. Dear God, thank you for taking care of us. Help us remember that you will always give us what we need. In Jesus' name, amen.
As we turn now to God's word, let's turn first to God. O Lord, you tell us in your scriptures that we do not live by bread alone, but rather by every word that proceeds from your mouth. And so this day we ask you to feed us. Feed us with your word, written in Holy Scripture. Feed us with your word enacted at the table of our Lord. Feed us with the word made flesh in Jesus Christ, our Savior, for we pray in his name. Our gospel passage is keyed from the Jesus Storybook Bible episode for this week. Last week we heard a teaching from Jesus on prayer that Matthew sets in the Sermon on the Mount, and today we have a follow-up message from the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' teaching to that crowd, and it has to do with anxiety, anxiety about material blessings. And so I invite us to hear the gospel today. From Matthew chapter 6. I'll start at verse 24. Hear God's word. Jesus says, "No one can serve two masters, for a slave will either hate the one and love the other, or be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and wealth. Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap, nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry. Say, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it's the Gentiles who strive for all of these things, and indeed your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for today." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. In my experience, it's not really a very good strategy to tell people how to feel. The stripes and scars of a pastor with graying hair will tell you I've made that mistake a couple of times along the way, telling somebody how it is to feel. You can invite people to act in a particular way, or you can remind folks that they don't have necessarily to feel in a certain way. They could think about things from another perspective, and that might help their feelings change. So I never really did credit too much that song from Bob Bobby McFerrin, to which Susan alluded earlier in the service about don't worry, be happy. The don't worry part, I can go with that. And that's what Jesus is saying here. The be happy part? Which is why I find it so compelling that Jesus is so directive in his teaching here with people who clearly are not moneyed and comfortable. This isn't a posh gathering at the club or the stockholders meeting at Berkshire Hathaway. The people who are gathered to hear Jesus talk at the Mount are likely the common people who are needful of direction and yearning for somebody who will speak to them with authority about God's care, but who will do so with the Spirit of God's care. So I picture them listening attentively. And when Jesus lifts up the topic of material concern, well, I see them leaning forward, because I imagine those people, even more than we do, would be in touch with material concerns. It's interesting to me and needful, I think, for all of us to recognize that just by being human beings, we have material concerns, right? They're inescapable. We live in bodies in time and space, and those bodies have physical needs. We need to provide for our nutrition. There's air to breathe, there's water to drink, there's food to eat, and if you have responsibility for more than yourself, then you have to provide that not just for yourself, but for others. And then there are others in beyond that in the hierarchy of needs that one might kind of think about. There's a constant beat going on in our lives about getting what we need. Jesus is so right about that and tunes into that concern in these people's lives, but also in our lives as well, because it's a universal. And what we can imagine if those people were poor people back then to whom Jesus initially addressed this teaching. But we can certainly imagine it in our lives, we who live in a very materially prosperous society and in a consumer culture. And we ourselves carry those kinds of material concerns and sometimes anxieties. If we have that problem, how much more the so many billion people on our planet with us who aren't off as well off as we are. So Jesus is speaking to all of us because all of us are at risk of getting turned away from the truth by the anxiety, the spiritual problem of anxiety about our material provision. Jesus can get away with saying, don't be anxious. And part of how he can get away with that is he's the Lord, right? Right? The Lord is the one whom we obey. And he has the authority to command that of us. But there's not some sort of authoritarian kind of take on this from Jesus. I hear kindness in his voice and an invitation to all of us, regardless of our station, regardless of our situation, not to allow the constant need for our provision to cloud the picture for us. What Jesus knows is that when we get anxious, our picture of God evaporates. Anxiety is the that time in our spirits and in our minds in which we start gripping. And what the brain science tells us is that once we start feeling fear, we act out of that that small and primitive part of our brains where it's just on or off, it's fight or flight. And all of the reasoning, all of the spiritual reflection, all of the warm, fuzzy parts of our life in our inner selves, well, that flies out the window when we're scared. And we shut down. And all we are is anxious. Jesus knows that. And so when he says, don't be anxious, I think we should take that as a blessing and an invitation to live the full life to which God wants us to have and to share. And not to be curtailed or cut short in our experience of the goodness of this creation in which God has placed us. So Jesus is caring. He's not scolding here, I believe. And the care is an invitation for us to recognize that all around us are signs of the character of God and the loving provision of a God who has mercy and grace at the center of the divine heart. Jesus says, you're more valuable than birds and you're more valuable than grass, but since they're right here in front of us, look at the birds and look at the grass and see how splendidly they are provided. How beautiful the colors in the meadow or the feathering of the birds. How it is that they are provided in their raiment, their clothing, if you will. How it is that just of their existence in the material creation, as God has made it, they are fed. That food sources are there for them to enjoy. And we are more valuable than birds or grass in God's sight. So if they are provided for, how much more would we be provided for? Jesus says, you don't have to be anxious. God's providing for you in the very material ways that you may not recognize because you're so anxious and you're driven right now. If your brain is shut down because you're scared, you're probably not thinking about the beautiful birds in the meadow, nor about the spiritual lesson of God's gracious provision for us that image would teach us. So Jesus reminds us that God's providing for us. Has provided, is providing, will provide for us. I know there's an interior argument that pops up in some of our minds, at least it does in mine, when I'm scared and anxious and somebody drops this little nugget on me about, well, you remember the birds of the air, Gordon? I want to say, well, you know, the birds of the air don't add money to my bank account. And the lilies of the field, there's no direct deposit from the lilies of the field to help pay my bills. We can argue with God and argue with Scripture and argue with the Lord who's telling us, the one who fashioned everything and who loves and redeems you. We'll get in an argument about Jesus doesn't really understand my life. Oh, okay. Right? Jesus doesn't understand suffering. Oh, yeah, he does understand suffering. Jesus hasn't been through... Well, actually, Jesus has been through that. God in Christ has been through exactly the anxiety that you are experiencing. And Jesus, that same Jesus, commands that we not be anxious. Invites us, gently, insistently invites us to claim the goodness of God. An openness of God's hands to provide blessings for us. If you're gripping, you probably aren't hearing that. But when you allow Jesus' voice to calm you. He opens you to the fullness of the bounty of God. Were we to trust this word more fully, we would feel safer, more secure, our needs met. And we would recognize that by seeking first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, that indeed all of the other things, the material concerns, are added to us when we focus our lives on the goodness of God shown us in Jesus Christ. You say, well, how does that work? It's not a direct deposit. No, but it does this. To recognize the goodness of God and to seek first the kingdom of God, the rule of God in my life and in our life together. Well, it makes me a better steward of what blessings I do have. I'm more responsible in the spending and the using of what is in my life. I am more generous with those around me because I recognize that the blessings I have are ultimately God's gifts to me, not for me exclusively, but for us in community. Seeking first God's righteousness, the kingdom of God, puts me implicitly in community with my sisters and my brothers, with all of God's children. I can't look at myself and say, I'm going to get mine and I'm going to keep it. But I have to reckon the needs of those to whom I am bound in communion one with another. And so sharing is not painful or scary or exhausting of our resources. Sharing is actually that by which God blesses the ones who receive what we share and blesses us in that act. Until and unless we listen to Jesus' teaching and allow his invitation to work in our hearts, our material insecurity will keep us gripping. And we will be tight and we will worry. And we will keep what we have so as not to lose it in some sort of ill-founded generosity. But when we listen to God, when we allow Christ's invitation to speak to us, we recognize that the rule of this life is not scarcity but abundance. That the same God who's inviting us to abundant life is the one who created everything that is, owns the cattle on a thousand hills, gave you your bodies in which to live and to thrive, put you in a community of people, God's people, so that there would be caring and generous folks with you materially, spiritually, and emotionally to walk your life with you and for you to share with. Seek first the kingdom of God and God's righteousness, all the other stuff, it'll come. You watch. And it does. Jesus says, don't be anxious. Don't be anxious. We don't need to be. We shouldn't be. Because the more confidently we can grab hold of the promise of God's love for us, the more generously we can share that promise with others. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
In response to God's word proclaimed, let us affirm together our faith. If you're able, please stand. What do you believe when you say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Let the eternal Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who out of nothing created heaven and earth with all that is in them, who also upholds and governs them by his eternal counsel and providence, it is for the sake of Christ, his Son, my God and my Father. I trust in him so completely that I have no doubt that he will provide me with all things necessary for body and soul. Moreover, whatever evil he sends upon me in this troubled life, he will turn to my good. For he is able to do it, being Almighty God, and is determined to do it, being a faithful Father.
Now let us bring to the Lord our tithes and our offerings.
Are guests of our Lord Jesus Christ.
So let us confidently and joyfully keep the feast which our Lord has prepared. Let us join together now in prayer. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
With joy we praise you, gracious God, for you created heaven and earth, made us in your image, and kept covenant with us even when we fell into sin. We give you thanks for Jesus Christ our Lord, who by his life, death, and resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we join our voices with all the saints and angels and the whole creation to proclaim the glory of your name. Eat this bread and drink this cup. We proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Lord, by your grace, you open up the fullness of your divine love to us. As if we belonged to you as children in your family. So we are. We praise you for that gift. May the promise of this table give strength to us in our living. Through Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
agree with me. We never thought that.
These two.